My name is Michael Deloach, and I will serve as the hearing officer for today's meeting. I'd like to take just a minute to give a brief overview of the process. First, I'd like to add as a reminder that this hearing is limited to the proposed implementation of the two affordability bill credits, one of which the board considered and approved last year. The hearing is not related to the setting of rates for water and sewer usage, nor is it related to other water board billing practices. The board is taking no action on this year's rate, and DEP does not intend to recommend any rate increase to the board this year. Second, please note that we place certain documents into the official record maintained by the water board. The first is a notice designating me as the hearing officer. The second, a copy of the public notices listing this hearing and an affidavit of publication of such notices. The drafts of the proposed water board resolutions implementing the two bill credits, and all written statements submitted by you, members of the public, to the water board. These items are marked as exhibits 1 through 4. In just a moment, we'll hear a presentation from New York City Department of Environmental Protection Chief Financial Officer Joe Murin on the bill credit proposals, and then we will open the meeting up to hear from you, the members of the public. I'd like to take a minute to acknowledge and introduce our commissioner at DEP, Vinnie Sapienza, and Nancy Seinplone, the Deputy Commissioner of the Bureau of Customer Service. Nancy and other DEP staff are on hand this morning to answer any specific questions you may have about your account. And also, if you have not yet signed up to speak but would like to, please take a moment to do so at the registration table right outside. I'd like to introduce the individuals joining me here today. We have our Chair, Alfonso Carney, Chairman of the New York City Water Board. Water Board members, Evelyn Fernandez-Ketchum, Adam Freed, Jonathan Golden, and Juke Su. Oh, I'm sorry, I got it wrong. Evelyn, I apologize. Arlene Shaw, not Evelyn, I'm sorry. New to this process, so apologies. The New York City Water Board Executive Director, Joe Murin, is here. Our Treasurer, Omar Nazem, and Al Rodriguez, the Secretary. Chairman Carney, do you have anything you want to add before we begin?
A couple of things, actually. First, everybody here, I think, is aware of the circumstances surrounding our decision at the last month's meeting to defer consideration of these two matters. I want to remind the public and our guests and staff that we were affected by a matter of litigation. That matter remains to be resolved, of course, but we did not know how that matter would affect our consideration of these two affordability matters at that time. We have since come to this conclusion that the hearing is necessary, and we here take testimony from the public. We're really pleased to be able to do that, but I wanted the issue to offer a personal apology, because I was not as transparent during that last meeting as I should have been with members of the public. You have a right to know why we were tabling the matters in the meeting, and I wanted to make sure that you understand that I now understand that I might have done a better job. That said, we are here to take testimony, to listen to what you have to say. You all know that we are very familiar with these two matters, and we look forward to hearing from any of you who choose to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. The Water Board would now like to welcome Joe Murin, Chief Financial Officer of DEP, to give a brief presentation.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Mr. Chair, as well. Thank you, board members, for being here, and thank you, young members of the public that are also here. So we have before us two resolutions that this is the topic of the hearing. These are two credits before the Water Board. The first is the Home Water Assistance Program, also known as HWAC expansion. This is an implementation of a credit to assist homeowners who are lower income seniors and or people with disabilities. The second is the Multifamily Water Assistance Program, MWAP. This is the implementation of a credit to provide relief to multifamily buildings that have agreed to enter into an affordability housing agreement with the city. To the first credit, the Homeowner Water Assistance Program, this is a credit of $115.89 per eligible account. Customers may qualify based on lower household income, senior status, subject to income threshold, disability, subject to income threshold. 53,000 customers eligible in fiscal year 2017 are already eligible for fiscal year 2018 credit. Remember that our fiscal year for the city runs on July 1st through June 30th date, so we're still in fiscal year 17. credits will post automatically, no application or paperwork is needed. The credit implementation before the Water Board is an expansion of the program for fiscal year 18. This will increase household income threshold for seniors from $37,399 to $50,000. As a result, an additional 12,000 senior customers will receive the $115.89 credit. With expansion, the total credit receipts for fiscal year 2018 are expected to be $65,000. The second credit, the Multifamily Water Assistance Program, this is a credit of $250 per eligible residential unit for qualifying multifamily properties. A property with multiple eligible units may receive one credit for each eligible unit. The main requirement for a property to be eligible, affordable rent for occupants earning no more than 6% of the area's median income, affordability agreement with HBD or HDC of at least 15 years, installation of both water meters and conservation fixtures in the units. That summarizes the two credits that are subject to this hearing, and I now turn it back to the hearing officer.
Thanks so much. We're now going to open up the floor for comments from the public. Again, if you wish to speak and have not signed up, please do so now. We ask that everyone keep their remarks to no more than 5 minutes, and we want to make sure that everyone who wishes to speak has the opportunity. I'd like to call on the first speaker, James Buckley from the University Neighborhood Housing Program.
UNHP is a nonprofit community organization that's been working in the Bronx since 1983. As we pursued fulfilling our mission, UNHP became aware of the issue across the border of the late 80s as we monitored the operating costs of several of the community-controlled buildings with which we worked. The board may recall, and I know some of you do, that several of us came to host those last year to testify in favor of the Multifamily Water Assistance Program. UNHP is still in support of the proposed program, and we recently completed an update to our water and sewer cost research that confirms the value of this program to affordable housing. The update, called Addressing the Ongoing Need for Affordable Water for Affordable Housing, we're very creative with our names, which we released on our website on Wednesday, confirms the impact of the cost of water on affordable housing and is the basis for our continued support of the proposed program. The proposed $250 per apartment per year credit will be a great help in eligible affordable housing buildings. We look forward to working with HPD and DEB to help publicize the program with affordable housing organizations, evaluate it after it is implemented, and to help fine-tune and expand it if needed. Through several of our other programs at UNHP, UNHP provides financial counseling and coaching assistance to neighborhood residents, and we work with a number of homeowners through these programs and our other homeowner outreach work. As a result, I also want to make clear that we support the expansion of the homeowner assistance program as well. I'll give you the report. I don't think you guys need to hear it. I can leave you a couple of copies of it. It's up on our website. The bottom line is affordable housing is being really squeezed. The credit that you're talking about providing here will be a big assist in many of the buildings with which we'll work. Now, we also know the bureaucracy of actually kind of implementing, getting the applications in and everything. You know, I know we still have work to do in terms of getting all that in place, but last year when the program was voted on and approved, before it ended up being kind of held up by the injunction, there were a large number of applications that were already prepared. So I'm envisioning that, and I suspect HPD is ready to roll in terms of bringing these applications back forward. I know we are. So we look forward to utilizing it. We look forward to kind of monitoring it, critiquing it as it goes along, and hopefully expanding it as it goes forward. Because I won't preach to the choir. You can kind of read our report and kind of see some of the evidence that kind of supports the notion that the cost of water in affordable housing is consuming a large percentage of both the income that's coming in, and it represents a large percentage of the expenses that that these buildings have. That's all I got.
Thanks.
Thanks.
I have a question. Is it necessary that the applications be construed to date?
I would, yes, would they have to update their application? They could just resend.
We'd have to talk to HPD because they are doing the whole process. We'll talk with them.
Yeah, so we'll follow up and, you know, let the chair and, you know, contact those applicants that we may have and let them know as well.
If you just take it, we can actually kind of ship them into you this afternoon.
I would just like to thank UNHP for their thoughtful and collaborative engagement on this. You very eloquently raised this issue 2 years ago to the point that made the board and the staff really look at this issue and offer solutions as well as identifying a challenge, and came back the next year to help us refine and support that. So I just want to thank you for continuing to engage with us in a very productive, thoughtful way.
Thank you. Should I leave these with? This is a few copies of the report and a testimony. Thank you.
Great, thank you. The next speaker is Herschel Weiss from the Shokan Services.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Herschel Weiss, president of Shokan Services. We represent 8,500 buildings in New York City. Look to us for water conservation concepts, bill monitoring, and guidance through the Water Board and the DEP regulations. We object to the two items on today's agenda. The New York City Water Board, we have no objection to doing it, just the money coming from the DEP. The New York City Water Board has done an excellent job at providing water and sewer services while keeping charges lower by sticking to its mission and only spending the money paid by its customers to actually provide and maintain the water and sewer infrastructure, etc., and not by diverting that money to anything outside its charter and purpose, such as pet causes of politicians. Think of the way the Port Authority built skyscrapers with the toll money that's supposed to maintain bridges and tunnels, which are now falling into disrepair while there's nothing left in the till to pay for the maintenance. If the Water Board is permitted to follow in the footsteps of such outfits and divert money paid by customers for water and sewer use, soon the Water Board and the good people at the DEP will just be another handy cash cow for politicians. The infrastructure will suffer, funds will dwindle, and charges will skyrocket because customers are not paying for water and sewer use, but also to support not only being used for water and sewer use, but also to support pork barrel handouts to whoever it pleases our city fathers to give them to. We therefore strongly oppose the proposed giveaways on today's agenda and demand the Water Board use any surplus money, which are really easy enough to spend, we're always hearing about projects that can't be funded, on projects to provide water service to its customers or pay down that ridiculous huge debt we currently have for capital programs. This brings me to a directly related matter. The stormwater fee that the New York City charges parking lots were instituted as a pilot program, meaning it was supposed to be a temporary experiment whereby the Water Board would study the benefits of such a program and its effects on stormwater conservation. A report with findings was supposed to be generated from which would arise a recommendation to maintain or modify the program subject to approval in the usual manner, or else the program would be dropped. Where is the report? What are the findings? Why is the program still in effect? If the DEP cannot support it with evidence from the experts who are supposed to monitor the study and get it approved, it must be dropped. It's not fair. The third issue is, due to this back and forth on the rate structure, we need clarification in regard to the MCP requirements. The DEP has not been enforcing the deadline in effect under the rate schedule. We know it was the DEP's intent last year to extend them, but the court struck down the proposed rates structure, and ordered the previous years to remain in effect. Under its term, the Grays automatically enrolled the properties to install DEP pool meters and AMR devices. The high efficiency fixtures expired on June 30th, 2016. Yet the DEP has not enforced this deadline to our knowledge. This has left your customers confused as to what the requirements truly are. The 17 structure says that properties won't be thrown off the MCP, but would see a penalty of 10%. But that was thrown out, so no one knows what the deadlines are. Likewise, there's no consistent rule as to whether a DEP applicant with a mixed-use building is required to separately monitor the commercial buildings with the downstream EP meter or by splitting them in. The rate schedule does not specify which is required, and the DEP has various required splitting, not splitting the DEPs without any application for a variance. On this matter, we request that you state what the rules are in an official memo. Thank you for your time today. I do appreciate this opportunity to speak.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Vito Signorelli from the Rent Stabilization Association. Sorry, I have to say last.
Before I begin, I love copies of our testimony with the young lady in the front.
Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, members of the Water Board. On behalf of 25,000 members of the Rent Stabilization Association, who own or manage nearly 1 million affordable rentable apartments in New York City, we thank you for this opportunity to speak. We commend this board for determining that rate increases are not necessary this year as a result of the elimination of the rental payments in the city, as well as cost savings realized by DEP. We also support the two targeted assistance programs that the Water Board is considering today. However, we are concerned that the multifamily assistance program is targeted too narrowly to only include buildings that receive government assistance. We ask the board to consider expanding this program to include additional buildings that meet all eligibility criteria other than the requirement that they be assisted through an HPD or HDC program. It is important to note that the vast majority of existing affordable apartments are privately owned and not assisted by HPD or HDC. Many of these own small mom and pop owners own buildings with 20 or fewer units. The owners of these buildings, the majority of which are pre-war buildings, continue to preserve and maintain these affordable units, often supplementing rental income with their own resources. To offer this multifamily water assistance program on a first-come, first-served basis to new government assistance projects is discriminatory against similarly situated private housing. In many cases, buildings that are government assisted sit side by side with non-assisted buildings that are occupied at similar rent levels by occupants of similar incomes. These are building owners who are still facing the effects of the 102% increase in water rates under the Bloomberg administration, as well as consecutive rent freezes administered by the City Rent Guidelines Board under this current administration. A $250 water bill credit per residential unit could be incredibly beneficial for these owners who take pride in providing the city's affordable housing. On top of extraordinary water rate increases over the last 15 years, as well as inadequate rent guidelines from the handpicked appointees of the RGB by Mayor Bill de Blasio, these owners have been bombarded with additional increased operating costs, primarily in the form of consistently increased real property taxes. This mayor's main platform has not only been to build new affordable housing, but preserve 120,000 existing units of affordable housing. Despite this goal, this administration seems to be doing everything in its power to harm the owners who already provide affordable housing, or having difficulty preserving it with this anti-owner agenda. A program that provides water credits to new government-assisted projects is only another example of that. According to DEP, the system is in strong financial condition, with nearly $1.1 billion in cash savings expected to come into the system in 2021 as a result of the elimination of the rental payment, as well as a budget for FY 2018 expected to be roughly $86 million less than FY 2017. However, only $11.4 million has been set aside for the FY 2018 budget for the expansion of these two programs. RSA strongly believes this program should be, at a minimum, expanded to private owners of existing affordable housing. Aside from assistance from HPD and HDC, the vast majority of these privately owned buildings already meet the required criteria to qualify for these programs, such as compliance with the multifamily conservation program and the maintaining of affordability of the units for much longer than the 15 years the criteria requires. With a large surplus in funds, as well as a strong financial state that the system is in, the Water Board is in a position to recommend that this program be expanded to the private owners of existing affordable units in order to assure that these small building owners can preserve these units in the midst of zero to minimal rent increases and ever-increasing operating expenses. On behalf of the members of the RSA, thank you for your consideration.
Thanks very much. At this point in the meeting, I'd like to open up the floor to any additional comments or questions on the topic of these two affordability credits. Does anyone in the audience? Yes, sir. Want to speak? If you could just give your name and.
Good morning, Mark Schwartz, President, New York Water Management. In a similar industry to Herschel Weiss of Ashokan, the twist is we have a sizable portion of our clients are low-income housing providers. And unfortunately, I did not prepare my speech ahead of time because I wasn't sure what you'd be putting up on the board. In reviewing the rules of the program that were put out last year, there were some questions that came about during the application process that there was no clarity on, and as such, the applications were denied. And I see the clarity is not there either, so I'd like to touch on it. One, a large amount of properties in New York City which have executed low-income housing agreements are not with HBD, or not with HDC, but with the state DHCR, Department of Housing and Community Renewal, or with the federal HUD agencies. So you'll have, to use the word that was mentioned before, a side-by-side property, but under a low-income housing agreement for 20, 30, some even longer, but won't qualify because it's with a state or a federal agency that I believe the city should recognize and should approve, but the rules were not approved for that agency. So that's something I think that should be clarified. The second and final item I'd like to comment on is what you state up there, affordability agreement with HBD or HDC of at least 15 years. And the problem with that is that the way they read the rules last year was with at least 15 years remaining. So it had to be a 30-year agreement during year 16, for example. 16, you do not qualify. You can have 14 years left in your agreement and you wouldn't qualify. And now we're at a point a year later where it's one more year that they've entered their agreement, but yet you won't, even more so, you won't qualify. We had several applications that were literally weeks over. And you'll have a 50-unit building that could have had a $12,000 credit, but you're missing it by a month. So I'd like to see if there could be some clarity now. Now is the important time to put the clarity into these rules, because once it goes to the agency for implementation, they strictly must look at those rules. So let's, my request to you is to clarify, A, the terms of the length of period left on the agreement, and two, that it also accepts state and federal low-income programs, so long as, of course, it meets the AMI requirements and everything else thereafter. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Does anyone else in the audience have any additional questions or comments? Great. Before we conclude this hearing, I'd like to remind everyone that the Water Board will formally meet to vote on these two bill credits at 10 o'clock today in the same location, 22 Main Street. Chair, do you have anything else to add?
Thank you all for your testimony.
As we have no further business, this hearing is adjourned. Thank you very much.